This video covers sections 78 through 81 of Hansen and Quinn's Greek and Intensive course and covers more case uses, specifically the subjective genitive, the objective genitive, dative of manner, and dative of respect. These four sections can be found in Hansen and Quinn on pages 242 to 244. Let's start with the subjective genitive. So you're going to be able to add this to your list of things that the genitive can do. And I'll just tell you right now that of and the noun in the genitive will usually serve you just fine as a translation of the subjective genitive. But anyway, it comes when we have a noun not in the genitive that has within it some implied verb. So if you have the noun hethousia, that implies sacrifice, as in somebody sacrifices something, or perhaps the noun hophobos, fear, which implies the verb fear or be afraid of. And that means that there's in that noun, in those nouns, an idea of something that could be doing whatever the action is. So you'll get phrases like hi ton helenon thusiai. And in this instance, with the subjective genitive, there the Greeks are in the genitive, you could be thinking that the Greeks are doing the sacrificing, that that's the relationship of the Greeks to this noun, sacrifices. And so we would translate it, the sacrifices of the Greeks. Let me just note again here that of the Greeks is really all you need to say there and not really worry about the fact that the Greeks are doing the sacrificing in this noun that understands a verb sort of thing. Okay? So, of the Greeks works just fine, and we get the sacrifices of the Greeks, and they're the ones doing some sacrificing, is the implication with the subjective genitive. In the same way, ha homeru phobos, you could think about that as Homer is afraid of something, and therefore it is Homer's fear. You could also translate that, the fear of Homer. Now, that might sound a little bit different to you. That can mean the fear that Homer possesses, his fear, the fear that belongs to him, the fear that he is feeling. Or it could be somebody who is actually afraid of Homer. And you can see there that in Greek as well as in English, we use the same construction to mean both the subjective genitive and also the objective idea here. Ha homeru phobos can mean the fear of Homer in a way that he is the object of the verbal idea that's implied in that noun. So somebody can be afraid of Homer, and then they've got a fear of Homer. Or the fear of Homer drove the other poets to excesses of work in order to compete with him, or something like that. So that same genitive can be subjective or objective. It's a little more obvious in some other contexts. So of and the genitive still works here. Ha ton theon phobos. As an objective genitive, that would be fear of the gods. So perhaps the fear of the gods kept the people under control. And as you can see, you can simply translate it of that default translation with the genitive and have it mean exactly what you expect it to mean in English. Another example, he ton agon thusia. So in this case, we've got sacrifice again, but we're to understand sacrifice the goats. That is, they are the object of the sacrifice. And we would say the sacrifice of the goats. But of course, you can see that exactly the same construction, even with the same noun, can mean different things. And the thing to learn really in all of this video, with the subjective and objective genitive, and also with the datives that we're about to do, is that you should pay attention to the context and use the idea in English that makes most sense with the Greek that you're seeing. So one would hope that when we're talking about sacrifices of the Greeks, it's not the Greeks who are actually on the altar being killed as an offering to the gods, that the Greeks are doing the sacrifices, and therefore the sacrifices of the Greeks, high tone helenon thusiai, is a subjective genitive. And the sacrifice of the goats, it's hard to imagine that they're the ones actually wielding the knife in that sacrifice, so they probably are the ones on the altar. And it's simply the difference in the context, in knowing what those nouns are about, that tells you the difference between subjective and objective genitive. Grammarians love to categorize as much as possible every single thing that a different case can do. And very often that's hugely useful to you to understand what's going on in a sentence. With these two genitives, though, you really only need to know that of is going to work as your default translation, and context will help tell you the relationship of the genitive noun to the noun that's not in the genitive. Let's move on to dative of manner. With some nouns that can answer the question how or in what manner, you can use the dative case without a preposition. And this chapter gives us a couple of nouns that we can do that with, tropos and sige. Our first example is tuto to tropo biblion egrapsa, or in this way I wrote a book. There we've got tropos in the dative case, modified by the demonstrative adjective, and it tells you in what manner, in what way, I wrote a book. So it gives you a how for the sentence. We can also do hoi stratiotai sige tous gerontas ephulaxon. So here we've got sige in the dative with no preposition, and that sentence means the soldiers guarded the old men in silence. There, the sige in the dative case all by itself is the same as our idiom in silence that tells us how, in what manner, the soldiers guarded the old men. Now, sige is special. It's unusual for a noun to do this in the dative all by itself without a preposition, without an adjective attached. So that's why Hansen and Quinn also tells you about some nouns that can do this with a preposition, sundike, apemphthesan ektes horas, or with justice, they were sent from the land. But of course, just translating the preposition the way you would expect will give you the same result. So I don't think that will trouble you. An example of dative of manner with a noun with an adjective, but using some vocabulary that we haven't done in Hansen and Quinn by Unit 9, but will be familiar to you later, is agathe tuche he polis esothe, which means by good luck, or with good luck, or in good luck, or we could even say luckily, the city was saved. And that's another example of dative of manner. Hansen and Quinn also wants you to distinguish carefully dative of manner from dative of means, hoi stratiotai hoplois tus gerontas ephulaxon. The soldiers guarded the old men with weapons. That, of course, is dative of means, or instrumental dative. With hoplois in the dative, we're learning what tools the soldiers used to guard the men, whereas with sige in the dative, we learned how the soldiers guarded the old men, in what manner. And really, the only difference there is the meaning of hoplon and sige. And you know which way to categorize it by what the noun is and what that means in context. So add dative of manner to your list of things that the dative can do, but remember that you're going to use it with certain nouns and not other ones. As you get more practiced in Greek, you'll learn by habit which nouns are likely to be dative of manner when you see them in the dative. You can use a noun in the dative to limit the area for which a statement is true, to indicate the respect in which something is true. So let's see an example. To men somati kalos honeanias, te de psuche kakos. In body, in respect to the body, in that part of things, the young man is beautiful, but in soul, in respect to that part of things, in that area, he is evil. You'll see this a lot in Menandes sentences, where Greek is happy to make a distinction and specify exactly where the turning point is. And again, you'll be adding Dative of Respect to your list of things that the dative can do. And when other things that are more common don't make sense, try this one, especially when you have a nice parallel structure like this in which the author is trying to make a very specific point about a contrast. So, for these new case uses, subjective genitive, objective genitive, dative of manner, and dative of respect, and of course, even dative of means, what you really need to do is look at the context, see what nouns you're dealing with, and then choose the translation that makes the most sense of that context and best reflects that context in English idiom. That's more case uses to add to your nice list of options, and I hope you'll get some good practice with that with the sentences and drills in Hansen and Quinn.